connect with you, whether it's your first time or you've been here many times. We'd like to know how we could be in prayer with you or for you, and also update any information. If you're visiting for the first time, we'd like to send you a welcome email and that sort of thing. So you could fill out the connection card or scan the QR code in the bulletin. Either way is the same thing. You notice in June, there's lots of birthdays that we're looking forward to and celebrating. If you noticed your birthday wasn't in the bulletin when it was your birthday, we need that information. So that's another good reason to take your connection card and fill that out for us. Good. So welcome. We're glad you're here. The Lord Jesus Christ is the most important person in our service. He's promised to be with us where two or more are gathered in His name. And after the Lord Jesus Christ, we hope that our guests, whether you're from Orlando or somewhere else in these great United States or around the globe, we're so thankful that you've chosen to worship with us today, and we pray that it'll be a day of refreshing for you. Just a few announcements. We are having a Vacation Bible School workers meeting following today's service over in the fellowship hall, and so please, if you have any part in Vacation Bible School, whether you're serving in the kitchen or as a teacher or whatever, we're having a meeting after service that you're invited to participate in. Vacation Bible School is only 7 days away. Next week, we're launching our Vacation Bible School. We're very, very excited about that. And so please register if you haven't done so yet. You could do so online. Our Vacation Bible School is unique from most in that it's for every age. Everybody is welcome. I have an adult class. We have crib babies all the way up to our adults. And so everybody's invited to participate. All we want you to do is go online and sign up. Okay, pre-register. Okay, there's a women's breakfast first Saturday of every month. That's at the Denny's on I Drive. They have the best service in Orlando, according to their sign, so you won't be disappointed. That's at 8:30 Saturday, June 3rd. And the guys have had enough. They're sick of being left out of breakfast. And so to not be outdone, the gentlemen are now having a breakfast at the same Denny's the week later, okay? June 10th at 9 a.m. We don't get up as early as the ladies do. So 9 a.m. at the Denny's for the greatest service in the world and also wonderful fellowship, okay? I appreciate Brother Carey for bringing that to my attention. We need a breakfast. And so he's in charge. He's responsible for it. So thank Carey. It's going to be a wonderful time of fellowship, okay? That's the second Saturday from here on out, right? Second Saturday at 9 on Denny's. Wonderful. Good. Our Vacation Bible School missions emphasis this year is school supplies. We're hoping during Vacation Bible School to have school supplies enough to give to both Sunshine Elementary down the street and our children's home, One More Child, okay? So during Vacation Bible School, we'll be collecting these school supplies for these schools and children's home. Good? Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together today, in which we are invited to cast our burdens upon the Lord because He cares for us. And so whatever burden, whatever struggle, whatever trouble might be weighing down on our minds, help us, God, in this hour to set those aside, to lay them at your feet, again, because you care for us, and help us to focus our heart's attention and our mind's attention on our Lord and Savior, who is worthy of our praise, our adoration, our worship. God, on this weekend and as a country, as we remember those who gave their lives on the battlefield in war, Father, we acknowledge their sacrifice and their service to our country. We acknowledge that we have a day of remembrance, of memorial, in which we freely celebrate, some by family gatherings, picnics, and beach trips or whatever. But we're able to have and enjoy those freedoms because of these brave men and women who sacrifice and surrender their lives in battle, in war. The Bible says that greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for a friend. And we know that ultimately, that's referring to our Lord and Savior, who died on Calvary for our forgiveness. But Lord, we also acknowledge the great love and devotion of these servicemen and women who died in battle. And if there's a loved one here, Father, who maybe a family member has given their life in the service for our country, Lord, strengthen them today, bless them today, encourage them today, and help them know in their hearts of hearts that their sacrifice was not in vain. We love you, and we worship, and we praise you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's sing.
Welcome, church. We're so glad that you're here. Let's stand and sing together, America the Beautiful.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains' majesties, all of the fruited plain. America, America, God shed His grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for pilgrim's feet who stern impassioned stress, authorial fear for freedom meet across the wilderness.
Together in Christ alone.
In Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when strife cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain.
Come on, church.
Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. Power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand till he returns or calls me home.
Thank you, Father God, for the power of Christ. We can stand on your promises, Lord God. We are so thankful for you, Lord, and for this place that we can call our church home. We can come and sing songs to celebrate our nation, to celebrate freedom, to celebrate you, Lord God, above all. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, church. You may be seated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What an awesome day to be in the Lord's house. For those that are visitors, welcome. You're looking there like, what's this dude up here? Yes, it's back. It's vacation Bible school time. It's tall. It's been being grown like that for a long time, so we're looking forward to that. Hey, 7 days from tonight, vacation Bible school kicks off. We are the most unique vacation Bible school in Orlando. One, we have dinner, and I'm not talking about frozen nuggets and fish sticks either. We got real food every night, and it's free. It's free. And then we kick off. We have classes for all ages, from zero to, you know, we even have a 100-year-old man right here in front that's going to be teaching a class. But we do, it's exciting, because you know what? The gospel is exciting. God is exciting. We want to share that. We're going to have a great time. So just you know, bring everybody. Pre-registration is open now until Saturday. It will be turned off Saturday night. So you'll have to, if you don't register between now and Saturday night, you'll have to register on Sunday. But with that pre-registration, I am doing a drawing. We're going to be giving away a gift card for a platter of Chick-fil-A minis. And for those who have never experienced the goodness of God's great gift of chicken minis, they're amazing. So we just kind of go from there. So I think that's all for me, right? Okay. As we enter time of worship through prayer today, we celebrate Memorial Day. Memorial Day is not about the men and women that are fighting right now. It's not about our veterans. It's about those that gave the ultimate sacrifice. Freedom isn't free. Salvation isn't free. Someone had to give their life. Someone had to give their blood for that. The men and women who are willing the men and women who willingly gave their lives for our freedom. We also have to remember their families that sacrificed there. The freedoms. Here's the thing. I saw a post this week, Miss Elizabeth was down in Brazil. If you think that America is terrible, go to Brazil. And then come back and you kiss the ground that you came on. Because here's the thing. We have so many freedoms. We have such a great thing here. This is something that I wrote down here. Only two defining forces have ever offered to die for you. Jesus Christ and the American soldier. One died for your soul and the other died for your freedom. Today, right now, we give thanks to both. So as we enter our time of worship through prayer, please continue to pray for all those service members who are serving right now, those family members who are grieving their losses. Continue to pray for what's going on in your own community, your own heart. For those that are here, please remember Brother Ron Christensen had a heart attack this past week. Doing better. They had to put some stents in, but he's doing better. Please pray for Brother Stephen, who's having issues with his diabetes. For those that know Suman, him and his family and his two little boys. Everybody knows the two little boys, those little active little four-year-old and a two-year-old, are on a 19-hour flight to India right now. Woo! Yeah, I hope you got some good Benadryl in that Kool-Aid. and go from there. And then a new one, his name is Kevin Carlin, Paul Carlin's little brother, stage 4 cancer. Paul will be leaving the Sunday after Vacation Bible School, brother. We're going to be praying for all that, so we're good to go. So let's take a few moments. Let's bow our heads. Let's have a conversation with God, and I'll come back and close this shortly.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for this brief moment
this brief moment that we are able to gather in your house as one family, your family, brothers and sisters, male and female, created in your image, loved by you, the eternal God, the everlasting God. Lord, you know each one of our sins, and you love us. You know each one of our failures, and you sent your Son to die for us. Lord, your arms are always open wide, Lord. We run away. We get caught up in life. We get caught up in things of this world. But you are there one step behind, Lord. No matter how far we run away, you are one step behind. Thank you for never giving up on us, Lord. Lord, as we celebrate today, the memories of those who willingly gave their life for the freedom of this country, who served, the men and the women who served. But Lord, we thank you for your Son who willingly went to that cross, who took that beating that we deserve, who took the punishment, who took the humiliation, was nailed to that cross, who died and arose 3 days later. The only one to ever walk out of hell. But he did that for each one of us. Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we pray for Brother Ron Christensen, Lord, that you would be with him. Lord, that you would heal his heart. Lord, that he would be a light for you in Dr. Phillips Hospital. Lord, we continue to pray for Brother Stephen as he is fighting this diabetes challenge. Lord, I pray for Kevin. I pray for his situation. You know him. You know him intimately. Lord, you know Kevin's brother, Paul. You know the hurt that is going on. Surround that Carlin family. Encourage them. Lord, that your will would be done. Lord, that he would see, Kevin would see the light that you are in his life. The greatest example, Lord, as his brother Paul carries that, Lord. Lord, we pray for Paul's heart and his mind, Lord. Lord, as we continue, Lord, we pray for this great nation that we live in. Lord, we see we see Satan running wild. Lord, we just pray that you just hold us tight. Breathe on us. Lord, we pray for Vacation Bible School. Lord, I pray for all those teachers and those leaders, Lord, that are getting ready to impact students. Lord, we pray for the hospitality team that's going to prepare 5 magnificent meals. The music team, which will get us pumped up and get us going. But all of this is for you, Lord, because you are the reason for Vacation Bible School. You are the reason as we go and we bring people in. We touch hearts, we touch minds, we touch lives. Lord, we thank you for that opportunity. Lord, as we continue today, Lord, open our hearts and our minds so you would have for us. In your Son's name, amen.
Amen.
Last week in the ladies' tea, we learned that the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And we can remember that each and every day as we wake up in the morning and we think about all the things that are happening, all the things that are going on. But we have that promise. We can hold on to that. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Church, it's Stand and Sing, Indescribable, and we know that God is amazing. He is an amazing God, and we have his joy within us. Let's sing together, Indescribable.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings. All exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim to our amazing God, who has told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laying with snow, who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God.
Thank you, Lord, because you are amazing. We love you, Father God. You're indescribable. There's nothing that can describe the awesomeness that you are in our lives, Lord God. Thank you for that. Thank you for this church and this family that we can come and sing worship songs to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, church. You may be seated.
I'll invite you to take your copy of God's Word and open to Paul's epistle. Not Paul. Paul didn't write Hebrews. The epistle of Hebrews. I'm so used to... No. Nope. Rewind. Let me... Hold on a minute. All right, here we go. All right. Please take your Bibles and open to the Epistle of Hebrews, chapter 10. We are in the midst of a sermon series on the fruit of the Spirit, okay, starting last week. And today we're looking at the fruit of the Spirit, joy. Joy. And so you could follow along in your Bibles. The words of the scripture will also be on the screen behind me. The word of the Lord. But recall the former days when, after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. Yet, for a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. May the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts and our minds and our hands as we seek to not only be hearers of God's word, but doers of God's word. So in the United States Declaration of Independence, we read that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So I guess the pursuit of happiness may be up to interpretation. Maybe each person, each family, looking at that a little bit differently. But I think over the history of our country, when you think of the pursuit of happiness, the term comes to mind, the American dream, pursuing the American dream. And if you break that down a little bit, the American dream oftentimes in people's minds has to do with the attaining of security and the attainment of status. Security, I think, goes alongside with feeling safe, having a sense of safety in your home, feeling secure in home, maybe living in a secure or friendly neighborhood, in a country that has secure borders and a strong military. I think that's a general definition of security. And status, I think, means achieving a sense of pride and satisfaction through symbols of success. Now, these symbols of success, again, are vary depending on who you're talking to, but maybe for somebody, working hard to be able to afford a vacation could be a status symbol, a symbol of success for them. Maybe a vacation home, maybe affording enough to put a down payment on a home, purchasing a home, purchasing a new car or a new-to-you car, that could be a symbol of status. Maybe a television set, I don't know, a sound system, a new computer, whatever. Whatever you, through your work and effort, could attain could be seen as, along with security and status, right, the American dream. Now, I want to contrast the pursuit of happiness and the American dream with what we're talking about when we're talking about the fruit of the Spirit, specifically the fruit of the Spirit, joy, right? Joy, the attainment of joy, the expression of joy, the experience of Spirit pursuit-filled joy is not equal to pursuit of happiness. Especially if we interpret it this way, right? Especially if we interpret happiness as the attainment of security and the attainment of status. Happiness, we often base it on what's happening around us, right? Happiness is oftentimes conditioned by pleasurable events and the accumulation of possessions. Joy, however, is more of a state of being than it is an emotion. The Christian and the fruit of the Spirit joy, or for the Christian, the fruit of the Spirit joy is something that one attains or one has regardless of security and status. I think they could both coexist, but oftentimes what happens is we're prone to ignore joy because we are so focused on happiness as attaining security and attaining status or stuff, particularly in a culture that's so commercially driven. And so you've seen this formula before, right? Maybe in church, a pastor, maybe in a Sunday school lesson on joy, someone may have told you that the formula for joy is this: putting Jesus and others before yourself, right? Joy is Holy Spirit joy. The fruit of the Spirit joy, Christian joy, is when we put Jesus and others before ourselves or before yourself. Now, I've heard people complain about that and disagree with that and argue that that's not really a good model or formula for joy. I don't want to argue necessarily if it's a good formula for joy or not, but I think it's great perspective for us to understand. Particularly what I want us to do is really be able to differentiate from our own lives, from our own experience, whether we are trying to pursue and attain to happiness, and if that is hindering or blocking or blinding us from the Christian experience of joy, okay? So we're going to look at this today, kind of this is kind of our outline, Jesus, others, and then yourself, okay? So the first thing we're talking about is the source of joy, the source of joy, which is Christ. Christ is the source of joy. Again, from the scripture for today, Hebrews 10:34, for you had compassion on those in prison and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. So this is pretty amazing when you look at what's going on in this text, and we're going to explain a little bit further in a minute. But Paul, the author to the Hebrews, is writing to these folks that were aligning with, associating with, coming alongside of a group of brothers and sisters in Christ that were experiencing persecution. And somehow, and we'll talk about it a little bit more in a minute, but somehow as a result of their coming alongside of these persecuted Christians, their property was being plundered or taken from them. And yet, even as their possessions were decreasing, in fact, they were decreasing, not only decreasing, but they were being robbed and stolen, yet they were still experiencing, right, joy. You joyfully accepted the plundering of your property. The word joy here means like a tumultuous, noisy excitement. They were giddy. They were excited even though their property was being plundered from them. And the reason that the writer states is because you knew that you yourselves had a better or a fuller and a lasting, abiding possession. They were able to be giddy, tumultuous, noisy, excited, joyful over their property being plundered, because that wasn't their inheritance. That wasn't their true possession. That's not what they were holding on to, or that's not what they were defining their life as. Their life was not equal to the amass accumulation of stuff. The source for that tumultuous excitement, the source for that noisy joyfulness came from their abiding, enduring, undescribable, untamable, eternal, abundant God. The objective reality of a living, abiding relationship with God, who is eternal, God, who is everlasting from everlasting to everlasting, that relationship with God made it so that they were full of joy even when all they had was being plundered. They had it now. It wasn't that they were thinking about as they were being plundered or as they were being robbed. It wasn't that they were thinking, well, oh, well, my mansion's in glory. Or, oh, well, I'm going to one day walk on the streets of gold. They weren't being delusional or escapist about it. They were in the moment in confident reality of their abiding, abounding, fulfilling relationship with God now. And it made all the difference for these Christians. That's why Paul is able to say in Philippians, where he writes from prison, right? What? Rejoice in the Lord. Don't rejoice that you're being plundered. Don't rejoice that you're suffering. Don't rejoice that you're in prison. But rejoice in that none of those things, that all of those things are fleeting. All of those things are temporal. All of those things are fading away. But what won't fade away is your present reality, your relationship with the Lord that's as enduring and as everlasting as the Lord himself. Rejoice in the Lord, not in things, not in circumstances. Rejoice in the Lord. What I'm trying to say is, since Christ is an objective reality, joy is an objective reality, and it's not commensurate with the amount of stuff that we have. Even happiness, I think there was a study done looking at a country. They measured, however they measure happiness, right? They try to scientifically measure the happiness of a group of people. And there was this particular country that had come out of communism and joined the European Union. And as it did so, the commercial prosperity of the country began to grow. And wouldn't you know, so did the level of happiness of the people in the country. But it was only short-lived. The prosperity continued to grow for the country. But the happiness didn't keep in step with the country's commercial success or prosperity. What does that tell you? Right? Money doesn't buy happiness. And it definitely doesn't have anything to do with abounding, eternal, objective joy. Joy is an objective thing. This isn't a sermon about how to be joyful. Joy is something that's a present reality that's actualized or realized or embarked upon by faith in that present objective reality. There's a story that Jesus tells in Matthew 13:44 about a man that's walking along this field and he happens upon this treasure that's hidden. And it's almost as if it's hidden in plain sight. And out of excitement, out of joy for finding that, sells all that he has. He gets rid of all of his possessions. And he buys that field for that treasure. And he says that's like the kingdom of God. It's not that he earned it. It's not that he worked for it. It says he found it. The author of Hebrews says, when you were enlightened, when you woke up, when you came to faith, when you realized what was already there. A little bit later on, in Hebrews chapter 12, specifically verse 2, the author of Hebrews says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So that could be interpreted as Jesus endured the cross because he knew what was coming after the cross. But at the same time, it was the joy that was before him in the moment. His joy wasn't in the suffering, wasn't in the shame that he was enduring, wasn't in the mocking, wasn't in the beating. But the joy was what was already there, always there. What he saw, how he lived his life, was in the presence of the reality of the kingdom of God, which is unshakable, which is immovable, which is eternal, which is abounding, which is lasting, which is forever. He was able to endure the cross because of the joy that was set before him, the joy that his eyes saw, even in the cross. When he told the thief, today you will be with me in paradise, it's because the eyes of our Lord always saw paradise, because the eyes of our Lord was open to the reality, the objective reality of God's kingdom, of God, of joy. We rejoice in the Lord. That's the source of our joy, is Christ. The expression of our joy is to others. The expression of our joy is to others. Hebrews 10 again. Oh, I'm sorry, this is backing up a little bit. Hebrews 10, but we're going to be backing up a little bit. Verses 24 and 25 say, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day drawing near. And then again from verse 32, but recall the former days when after you were enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to reproach and affliction, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those in prison, and you joyfully accepted the plundering of your property, since you knew that you yourselves had a better possession and an abiding one. So a little more about what was going on here, right? These folks that the author was writing to, when they were enlightened, or when they came to faith, when they came to accept and recognize God's gift of salvation in Christ, when they received that, something went on to cause a public stir, a public persecution of the Christian community. And for however the cards fell, maybe half the group was taken up in this persecution and carted off to prison. And the other half, because of their alignment with, because of their support of those that were being persecuted, they suffered. And what happens is the state doesn't flip the bill for the prisoners. If you're in prison, someone has to sponsor you. Someone has to support you, most likely a family member. But in this case, what was going on was the group of believers that were carted off to prison were being supported and upheld by this other group of Christians. And so what is the plundering of their property? Well, it might be that they offered their property up to pay for and to be able to support these other Christians, which made them rejoice and be glad, be excited about not caring to give their possessions to support these poor Christians in jail, because that wasn't their inheritance, that wasn't their portion anyway. They had joy in the Lord. Or maybe it was that while they were visiting with the Christians in prison, looters and thieves and plunderers came and robbed them blind while they were ministering to the folks in the prison. And so we see that the joy is closely related to their support, their sacrificial giving, their alignment with another group, of people who are suffering hardship, right? Joy is expressed to others but more so joy is expressed when we stop thinking about others as others. What do I mean by that? Well, just this week, right, early in the week, one of these days it was like really cloudy and about to storm later on in the afternoon. Maybe it was Monday or Tuesday, around here at least. I don't know where you live. And sometimes, there's no really rhyme or reason, but sometimes when it's that, when a strong thunderstorm is coming, I don't know if it's barometric pressure, I don't know what or if it's humidity, but every now and again when there's a bad storm coming, I get a headache, a bad headache, right? Usually, if I, you know, ignore it for a while, it'll go away, or if I take, you know, Advil or something like that, it'll help. But that helps me realize that I'm more connected to the environment and to what's going on than I oftentimes let on that I am, right? I often see myself as separate from everything around me, the environment that I live in. But that's probably a bad way to look at things. I know of people, and you might, does anyone suffer from seasonal allergies, right? Something is in the tree, something, pollen, a flowering, whatever's going on, and that causes you to be miserable. Some people suffer from seasonal depression, right? It's just something in the air, something in the environment that causes you to be depressed. You're connected to the environment that you find yourself in. The water source you drink, it's all connected, right? The pandemic showed us that, how connected we were, not only to our community locally here, but to the whole world, how it was a global phenomenon. But I think the ego and the flesh is that, you know, it's me, I'm separate from that. If there's a problem, if I have a headache, it doesn't matter that the storm, I ignore the storm or I ignore all that, I just have to take Tylenol, right? The same thing, I think, when we travel, when we visit abroad, right? What's most noticeable to us, oftentimes, when you travel abroad, are the differences, right? People don't talk the way I talk. They don't speak the same language that I speak. They dress differently than I do. They eat differently than I do. They communicate differently than I do. The government is different than my government. Everything is different, right? There's a difference. There's a separation. But the more, I think a better way to look at it is, I don't like food that spicy. I wouldn't necessarily pick that for my enjoyment, but the calories from my food is the same as the calories from their food. It's producing energy to go about their lives, right? We both eat. We both breathe the same air. We both communicate to our loved ones. We both work to try to provide for our loved ones. We're more alike than we are different. But in the flesh, we tend to look more at the differences than we do at the sameness. Why am I saying all that? Well, I'm trying to illustrate that these folks from Hebrews chapter 10 had joy in the plundering of their things and the support of their fellow Christians because they recognized what? Love your neighbor, what? As yourself. You'll experience joy when you experience your neighbor as being more like you than not like you. But in the flesh, if we're looking for the attainment of status and the attainment of security, we see people as a threat. We see people as competition. We see resources as limited, and this is mine, and how could I give what's mine over to you because it's for me and my family, not for you and your family or your problem, right? That's not joy. That's the flesh taking control and trying to believe that we own things, that we're separate from, that we're different than, that we have more of a right to. But when we look at the example here, we see that they had joy, and the reason they had joy is because they gave to others instead of separating themselves from the others. In other words, joy is an objective reality. The source of joy is Christ. But whether we see it or not, or whether we stumble upon it or not, or whether we experience it or not, often has to do with whether we're looking at other people as different and separate and enemies and competition, or whether we see them as neighbors and brothers and children that are made in the image of God. The reason I brought up the earlier passages, 24 and 25, is he's talking about church. I think church is the test kitchen of joy, right? If we meet together and we're to continually meet together, it's not only for singing, although the singing is wonderful and has a beautiful meaning, and we're all sharing the same breath, singing the same words of praise to God. And it's not only for Bible study, but where the rubber meets the road is when our brothers and sisters that are in church have needs and are suffering, whether we are able to look at them and say, well, that's them and I'm me, or whether we see like the people in this book did, well, we have a need, they have a need, therefore I have a need. Or if I have a way to fulfill that need, I'm fulfilling that need to me because they are me. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Okay, and then finally, the endurance of joy. The endurance of joy. Verses 35 through 39, the endurance of joy. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. The writer here is telling them about their need to endure in the faith. Why do we need endurance? Why do we need to talk about endurance? Or how is joy reflected in our endurance? This is, I think, the self-reflective part of the sermon, okay? This is where we measure ourselves up to the standard of God's Word. Again, I think the default leaning of the flesh is to boost itself up, to suit itself, to meet its needs, even if it's in opposition to or in competition with other people. That's, I think, the default of things, right? I'm not saying that it's wrong to pursue security or wrong to pursue status. I'm saying that that's not Christian joy. And it could blind us and keep us from experiencing and seeing Christian joy. I'll give you an example. I think it was 2005 or 6, 4, 5 or 6, when Hurricane Wilma came, the eye of Hurricane Wilma came crashing through my front yard. Not literally, but where I lived, right? I was in Palm Beach County, and we experienced Hurricane Wilma, and it came through our county. The first part of the storm didn't do that much damage, but that second part after the eye wall came through was very devastating. I was a youth pastor, associate pastor of the church that where I was serving was right across the street. So when the storm had quieted down, I went over to the church to take a look at what had the damage was. And there was regular storm damage. Trees were down. We had a gazebo that was no longer there. Regular storm type damage. But I walked to the back of the church, and I noticed that there was a piece of the building that was no longer there, and that the electrical service coming into the building was ripped off the wall. Now, that doesn't mean that we didn't have power because the transformer blew or because there was a down power line. This means that the ability to have electricity in our church building was, it was impossible because the service where the electricity was coming into wasn't there anymore. It ripped off the wall. And I thought to myself, that's going to be expensive to fix. I thought to myself, even the deductible to be able to pay the insurance to have this kind of repair fixed is too much that we could afford as a church. And I thought to myself, I'm not going to have a job in a few weeks. And I thought, how am I going to support my family? What are we going to do? And as the church was figuring, you know, how to get that set up and you know, talking to insurance companies, for that next week, I remember I was not a nice person. I was upset. I was cranky. I was moody. I was sad. I was anxious, maybe even a little bit depressed. And why? Well, I mean, hurricane's a pretty traumatic stress. But I think that I was so focused on, I don't think I was looking at the joy that was mine in Christ during that time. I think I was believing that my security and my status, that my position in this world, my value to my family, my value to the church, was the sum total of, right, all my possessions, all my security, all my status. And without all that, I didn't know who I was. I didn't know where I was going to go. I didn't know what I was going to do, all of that stuff. Again, if I was a Christian, joy was there. If I was a Christian, joy cannot be, you know, like Jesus said, listen, store up your treasure in heaven where thieves cannot break in and steal and moths cannot come in and destroy. Do not store up your treasure on earth. Store up your treasure in heaven. So I had to have a reality check. I had to have a come to Jesus moment, so to speak. And I had to have a recognition that why am I so angry? Why am I so depressed? Why am I so anxious? Why am I so out of sorts? Why am I so short with people? It's because I was threatened. My ego was being threatened. And in a way, that was a very, very good thing. Because if we're going to experience true joy, if we're going to experience that rock, that cornerstone, if we're going to experience that abundance, that immovable, that eternal, that indescribable, all that we sang about, if we're going to really experience that, then the ego has to take second place. The flesh has to get out of the way. Our focus, our attention, our minds, our hearts need to look at, by faith, the source of our joy, which is Christ. That there's nothing in this world that could steal that joy from you. There's nothing in this world that could damage who you are in Christ. There's nothing in this world that could separate you from the love of Christ that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's no circumstance. There's no suffering. There's no disease. There's no nothing that could keep you from Christ. And that is the cornerstone. That is the rock upon which we stand. If peace like a river attendeth my way, or sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. The end of that story, by the way, I don't think I shared in the first service, I forgot all about it, was somebody outside the church donated the money to cover the deductible to get our electric service put back on the wall. And I stayed at that church 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 12 more years. Eventually as pastor of that church. So why was I Why was I discouraged? Why was I mad? Why was I short with people? Why was I depressed? It was my ego. It was the flesh. It needs to die so that our spirit could take the lead. Let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy that we have in Christ, our Lord. That's really what's real. Father, so often we put our faith in, our trust in, our hope in things that are temporary, God. Help us not to do that. But by grace through faith to trust in you, that our joy may be complete. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing this hymn of the faith together. Oh, come to the altar.
Church, let's sing together, O Come to the Altar.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Time together, if you're happen to be a Vacation Bible School worker, volunteer. We're going to have a quick meeting after service today. Don't rush off before greeting one another. Take an opportunity to say hello to somebody, to shake somebody's hand, to pat somebody on the back. You might be the encouragement that they need today to just get through the day or through the week, okay? So love on one another. Have fun tomorrow. Be safe. Enjoy. If you have the day, the time off, enjoy your Memorial Day, and don't forget to pause in remembrance of those that sacrificed their lives. Now may the Lord bless and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, lift up his countenance upon you, and give you peace. We'll see you soon.